speaker enough time and more people can come in. So I'll give a brief introduction. So Dr. Hongwei Ku is from Oakland University, from the Department of Electrical Engineering. He's been there for about 11 years now. And he works in the area of MEMS, mainly. So for those of you that are juniors right now, you will take a class of Intro to MEMS with Dr. Lee in your final semester. And some of you that are seniors are already in this class, so you already know about MEMS. MEMS is an acronym for microelectromechanical systems. So these are structures which are usually mechanically moving, as you can see right here. But they are made with the same kind of techniques that are used to make transistors and CMOS technology. So that's his area of research. He'll talk about it. I have mentioned to him that most of the people are students, and they might not have too much of a background, so he's going to try to cover a little bit of that as well. We'll give him the floor for about, maybe about 40 minutes, and then we'll have time for some question afterwards. And so I guess with that, I'll just let you go.
Thank you, Master. So glad to be here. So I've been here a couple of times before for different things, and I have a chance to present what I've been doing here at the OU, and also my previous research, basically is CMOS MEMS. It's kind of an integration technology, how to combine MEMS and electronics together, all right? So today's talk actually is a little bit special because of the these slides are for like research in CMOS MEMS, but I would like also present what other project, all right, not like a CMOS MEMS, just like this kind of, actually it's a metal MEMS, it's a metal MEMS technology. So, but I will just start with the major part, CMOS MEMS technology and devices. And as Master already introduced, I'm from Oakland, and I graduated from University of Florida there. It's one of the major group in the US to do MEMS integration using CMOS MEMS. Actually, particularly, I will see this, I understand for most of you probably it's too specialized, but hopefully you have an idea, okay, what people can do right now using mainstream CMOS technology and MEMS, and then we can put things together to have amazing things working in different places. Now MEMS actually everywhere. I start with some examples, and then so this is mainly for the research, all right? How you package, how you integrate the MEMS and the circuits together, and with so many different ways, okay, I cannot cover all of them. I just focus on we call monolithic integration. Monolithic means we put electronics and MEMS structures on the same silicon chip, right? So on the same substrate. So that's a very particular technology. And then I give some examples. We will certainly with different technology, we have different industrial product. I give some example. And if I have other have time, I can introduce other devices as well. Okay, what's MEMS already? MEMS already mentioned MEMS, the first acronym of microelectromechanical system. It's the definition, all right? So many different definitions, but this one particularly is from MEMSnet. Okay, it's a microscopic mechanical elements, right? Fabricating silicon chips, actually should be all other materials by techniques similar to those using integrated circuit manufacturing for use as sensors, actuators, and other functions. Right? This is the definition from MEMSnet. It's here. I give one example. Right? So electrical and mechanical parts on macro scale. For example, this one. Very small car, mini car, actually it works. Is this MEMS? It's not, all right? Although it's a small macro scale and we have electrical, we have a mechanical component there, it's not MEMS. Particularly here, it's very important, MEMS is using like IC-related technology. It's a planar CMOS or like a semiconductor technology, solid state technology, all right? And with batch fabrication, mass fabricated a lot, all right, to reduce the cost at the same time, because the scaling effect, so even though we make the very small, it's still quite reliable, all right? So the device you see there, you think it's very fragile, actually no, it's very robust. Okay, so this is the huge difference. So certainly why we make things small. So I already mentioned, we have a physical, like a scaling, all right? So the, when everything just goes down, still we have the same like effect. We still have the same skill of output, input, or sensitivity. So that's why we can make this 20-pound gyroscope. Gyroscope is a device to sense the rotation, all right? No matter it's your pitch, raw, basically, it's a gyroscope. And now we can make everything on silicon chip. This is the monolithic integration of electronics surrounding this mechanical structure, right? It's from an analog device. It's a MEMS gyroscope. So what's the size? 3 millimeter compared to this 20 pound, probably 2 feet by 3 feet, right? So they have similar sensitivity. They do the same job, right? That's why we try to make things small, right? Here, so this is a starting point for like introduction of MEMS, but MEMS right now, because everywhere we have a bio-MEMS, we have a RF-MEMS for communication, for like a high frequency signal handling. We have so many based on their application, based on their fabrication technology. There are too many ways to categorize them, all right? So I cannot like put classification of MEMS here, so because we have too many ways. So today, particularly, as I mentioned, I just focus on one aspect of MEMS, CMOS MEMS. So here, so some of you may not be very familiar with the MEMS. Actually, can give you a brief introduction of some MEMS, successful MEMS products. Here, the first MEMS device actually is a pressure sensor. Pressure sensor, what pressure sensor for? Always because we're in Detroit, all right? So we can give examples of MEMS applications in automobiles, which is this smart tire, all right? Tire pressure monitoring system, basically for some fancy cars you start, it immediately tells you basically the three wheels, the pressure there, right? So air pressure, if it's so lower, can give you alarm, all right? So that pressure measurement, 100% the MEMS device, all right? So the first generation of MEMS device actually is a pressure sensor. Right after people realized silicon, amazing material, not only their electrical property, semiconductor, you can make electronics, make the device circuits. At the same time, it had excellent mechanical property. So we have Young's modulus and the harness, the mechanical property is also excellent. So people create later on, they found even other physical effects like a piezo resistive effect. So actually, the first generation of pressure sensor is based on piezo resistive effect of silicon. And certainly, later on, they will figure out a way to manufacture, to process, all right, in such a way we can do it in batch, just similar to IC technology. That's why we see MEMS everywhere. Right, then in 1970s, basically, HP first invented this inkjet printer. All right, so the high-end printer, color printer right now still is a MEMS printer head. So basically, we have reservoir, we have electro actuation It's piezoelectric actuation, basically you apply voltage, get like or some device with a thermal effect. You heat it up, it expands, it just ejects ink to the surface of paper. So that's the basic idea, all right? So because, as I mentioned, we can process silicon into different shape, different 3D structures, we bond them together, we have this macrostructure, we can get very high resolution image. So this is the next generation of Epson's, it's called the precision core technologies, the extremely high resolution. Probably right now they have a printer, basically to be 2,000. So now our printer probably just a few $10, right? So it's a very high resolution. And next, the most successful macro device probably is the DLP. Probably you know this, all right? DLP is as close as in this room we have DLP. We have this projector actually. It's a maybe it's an LCD, but PLD is a also everywhere, so for IMAX, right, so this cinema, they have a DLP technology. So on this chip, you have millions of, it's called a DMD, digital macro mirror device, right, so we use digital technology to control each pixel, actually each pixel is one macro mirror, right, so it's a MEMS device, actually this is a kind of CMOS MEMS. This is built on top of a CMOS chip. The chip can address each individual pixel and actuate related tune. So the frequency determines the grayscale or darkness or brightness. And then the location, this particular location is addressed by a digital circuit. Yeah. And with a color wheel, and that's the principle of a DLP project. Yeah. And most recently, I found people already apply this DLP technology for 3D printing, right? To address different locations and then solidize the resin and then you create like a 3D structure. That's the probably most recent application. And then look at your smartphones, MEMS device everywhere. Okay. So we have IMU, first IMU means the inertial measurement unit, basically you sense your motion of your hand, all right? So you rotate your image, your video also rotates. Why? Because there's a device I will talk about, it's an accelerometer, basically, or gyroscope to sense the rotation. And then we have a magnetometer, so basically this is macroelectronics device, you can call it MEMS also, right? Pressure sensor, microphone, digital microphone, all this can be done by MEMS. And because it's so small, the size is so small, you can directly pack it even on the PC board. So to reduce the size even further without the packaging of the MEMS device, as long as it works, so we are not talking about reliability like a aerospace devices or even more automobile. Therefore, consumer electronics, the robustness is not as high as that, but it'll be fine. And actually, two of my friends, basically at Apple, they are doing research in macro lens, just using MEMS to realize this control of the lens, actually, so for camera. So it's basically MEMS everywhere, but the most significant increase in recent market for MEMS is from consumer electronics, the smartphone, and also medical devices. This is the data I got from the Yours, the main consulting company, basically doing research in MEMS. Okay, so you can find this green and this like orange, you have largest increase in recent years. Okay, so it's very critical for next generations of VR, for IA, and the artificial intelligence intelligence and the virtual reality, basically you see this device everywhere. So we have tens of MEMS devices can be embedded in the VR equipment. Also, next generation wearable MEMS devices, right, can be embedded directly into your clothes. Here, so again, we're in Detroit, so for to talk about vehicles, okay, where can we find MEMS in a car? All right, so currently probably most of car, basically we have a 20 to 50, 20, I think. Okay, so this is not the one. Here 22, we have like a average 27 sensor in a car. All right now probably it's over 50. Most of them actually can be replaced by MEMS device. It's not every, but many can be replaced by MEMS device. For example, again, one of my friends basically hired by Ford, basically doing acoustic, right? Applying MEMS devices for like a noise reduction, right? For the wind noise cancellation, and this is basically they use microphone and this tire monitoring pressure sensors right here, IMU to sense vibration, and the ES. It's a different company called different name, all right? So the gyroscope to electric stabilization system, all right, ESP program. That's the accelerometer and the gyroscope, and even people think about using silicon nozzles to replace the fuel injection system, all right, to get even better control of the fuel injection. All right, so this mostly, as I mentioned, sensors. What's sensor? Sensor basically is to convert physical parameters into electrical, right? This sensing. Actually, we also have so many other MEMS devices, as I already mentioned. So we have actuators. Actuator basically apply electrical. It's energy flow is from electrical to other domains. So basically, you apply electrical signal, current, voltage, you get other physical parameter, displacement. All right, that's actuation. You get temperature, the temperature, that's measurement. All right, you can have like a heating, right? Heater, the electric thermal actuation, that's another matter for actuation. So see, this is the polysilicon tweezer. It's to hold the 10 micron of this fiber for fiber manipulation. And this is an electrostatic micromirror. Micromirror, we have a comb drive, apply voltage, you have electrostatic force. Basically, once you have force, you can generate displacement. Then you design some gears, design other mechanical elements. You can push this up and down and to direct light beam to different places, right? If it's aligned, it's on. If it's misaligned, it's off. Basically, it's a mirror can also be optical switch. This is BioMEMS. Basically, it's called lab on a chip, all right? So we do analysis of different parameters, basically from electrolyte or from well samples, we duplicate DNAs. This PCR, this technology can integrate all of them on the same substrate, basically to call it a total analysis microsystem or lab on the chip. And certainly this also fabricated using MEMS technology, you can create the macro like channels on surface for surface of silicon or other material, probably glasses, and to achieve this complex system. All of this you can find, basically everything is on surface of the silicon. It's a surface structure. All right, how to fabricate this. Basically, I think Dr. Lee's class will cover this in more detail. Here is a it's not the topic of this seminar. Okay, now CMOS. Dr. Nasser just mentioned, probably some of you may not have an idea of microelectronics. I just particularly add this CMOS. It's a complementary metal oxide semiconductor. It's the main solid state technology to create electronics. Basically, it's circuits, right? Integrated circuits. So the element actually first is the MOSFET. MOSFET is a field electric, like a field effect transistor. Okay, FET, basically, I'm not going this detail, it's a solid state, wherever your electronics class will cover this a little bit. It's a building block for any complex circuit. Right, we have anybody recognize this for the function of this circuit? Just like one of these two states.
Switch.
Anybody recognize this? It's called CMOS inverter. Right? Inverter, we have one PMOS, one NMOS. What's P, what's N? Alright, so I cannot go that detail. Basically, we put a okay, this is one transistor, right? It's the MOSFET. This is another. What's the difference? They are built on different substrate. Alright, so here this one is built in P substrate, P silicon. Alright, P type means we don't group three elements into silicon. We get a bunch of you can call it a positive charge. Actually, it's not physically positive charge, it's a state, alright, you can call the holes. And then you dump group five material into silicon, you have a bunch of electrons. You change the electrical property of silicon. That's what I mentioned. All right, silicon is amazing. We have the semiconductor electrical property and also mechanical properties. All right, so we wire them together. This is the technology. Everything happens on the surface of silicon. All right, you can only create layer by layer, each time one type of layer. Alright? For example, first you do this, create this this particular area, and then you have on top you get a gate. So just have an idea, alright? This element is a device element. Alright? Certainly CMOS also means first this is the structure and devices. Right, this is the building block for any compact circuit. Intel, right, so the process, no matter how complicated and millions of this kind of gate circuit, digital circuit. Alright, so the inverter means it's logic. Alright, get this high, get one, the output will be zero. Alright, get zero, output will be one. You get two stage, basically you invert again. So this is the again, when you process this, you can only process different color, represent different material, right? Different sequence. You must process every time just one layer, all right? Layer by layer, it's planar fabrication technology, means we have mask, we have every time we process on the surface, so that happens everywhere, all right? You process one type of material, it's on a big wafer, as this, but each time you just process one area for this device, the grid area here, and then we have millions on this wafer. Okay, then you repeat for each different layer. You repeat using different mask, carries different information of this layer, and then you process this way. This is the integrated circuit technology. All right, so it's a solid state. Just process everything on solid silicon wafer. It's not MEMS. MEMS means we have a mechanical structure, it's a movable mechanical structure. That means we must create some suspended structure. All right, but this is the pure solid state. All right? So This solid state is to create electronics, right? Circuit to process the signal, right? Amplify the signal, process signal, modulate to like a standard protocol, right? For we know 2.4 gigahertz, 5.8 gigahertz, right? For different technology communication. So the signal will be different. So this electronics is to do that, right? But MEMS device is to pick up first stage of a signal from a non-physical environment, right? Temperature, pressure, or acceleration, this motion signal, that will be picked up by MEMS sensors. And then immediately electronics will process the signal, get amplified, and get modulated, then transmit, then receive from your smartphone, and then demodulate, then amplify the circuit, the signal, then you hear the voice. The pickup by the microphone. The microphone is the MEMS device, okay? So we must figure out a proper way to integrate this MEMS and circuit together. So what's the general, if I ask you, okay, what's the general consideration? Small size, that's also all right. So now we can get everything smaller and smaller because the advancement of our technology. So high reliability, miniaturization, all right, small size, and low cost through batch fabrication. All right, so this batch fabrication like this, all right, you fabricate this huge wafer, now 8 inches, next generation 12 inches. 12 inches is 1 foot, all right? 12 inches, you can imagine how many circuit, how many chips you can get from one batch. So reduce the cost by increasing the batch of process. Okay, so here power is very advanced technology here. So the current trend for integration of MEMS and the CMOS basically is to have like a 3D package, 3D stacking, right? Like this. I'll not go to detail. This is the it's from ST, right? ST is a major provider for MEMS, like inertial sensors and smartphones, but it's dominant. Actually, in 2013, it was number one MEMS provider. Right, then the same year they lose contract with Apple. It just slipped into second. The first one right now still is Robert Bosch. Bosch basically is the largest provider for automobile MEMS devices. Right, it's high reliability. Right, they have an office here. I think it's Farmington Hills over there or Norway there. So this particular technology is very expensive. It requires very expensive equipment. Right now, the one fab, all right, for MEMS, for any solid state device, probably will cost 100 billion, probably 10 to 20 billion, all right? So it's not what we can do at the university. Even we have a research center like University of Michigan, we have a nano fabrication facility, is not equipped for this kind of advanced package. Okay, so I will not go there, so I will just focus on this monolithic CMOS MEMS. MEMS will create everything on the same chip, right? So on the same wafer. No bonding, no this like a 3D stacking. Okay, so basically, still we have this requirement. So monolithic property is even better because everything on the same chip, all right? So no 3D, no alignment, no any other technology involved. It's just pure CMOS. We can get it from like IBM, we get a TSMC from Taiwan semiconductor manufacturing, and from Samsung, and we can all provide this fabrication service. Then we just use their technology after we get our CMOS part down, we create our sensors on same wafer. Okay, this is the difference from a 3D package, that kind of integration. Right, based on the sequence of CMOS was first, all MEMS first. Certainly different community had different approach. Right? So for example, this pre-CMOS MEMS means basically we create MEMS first. All right, this is from Sandia National Lab. Their approach basically with help of UC Berkeley. And in 1990s, basically they first create this trench and then create MEMS in the trench, then bury the MEMS in this trench in the oxide, then they fabricate this microelectronics. All right, so this integrated circuit, they get connection everywhere, then they just expose the MEMS. Then that's the whole device. It's called pre-MEMS, all right, pre-CMOS MEMS. Okay, then analog device has this particular technology because it has its own dedicated fab or facility. So they have to call the intermediate CMOS MEMS because they have its own facility. They create first CMOS on the bare wafer first, and then they stop. They start to create MEMS using one like a metal layer for interconnect. Deposit and the name of a MEMS structure material, the polysilicon, and then you have one interconnect metal layer. So that's before we complete everything, and so they jump back and forth between circuits and MEMS, right, in their fab, different location. So this is their approach. So actually, the analog device is also one of major supplier for automobile MEMS. Okay, so this is their accelerometer. A gyroscope. No, they approach the gyroscope with two separate math. All right, so this is just an accelerometer. It's a motion sensor. It senses the vibration of the vehicle. Okay, you see the circuit is surrounding the mechanical structure. Okay. So here, so we actually originated this technology from UC Berkeley, and people using different method, all right, to create a structure in or on the surface of silicon, all right. So we have a thin film, or as this generally is called post-CMOS. After the most CMOS part is complete done, we just created MEMS structure on the chip or on the wafer. Okay, so certainly a lot of different detailed technology. What method do you use to create that? Use the dry method or use wet method? So dry wet means basically you have different solution to basically to etch, all right, to create the structure. So here's the general research approach. Basically, what we did, all right, even at Auckland. So we choose foundry, and then we design, then we send out for CMOS fabrication, then we create MEMS structure at the UOM, their clean room, basically to etch through the wafer to release the movable mechanical structure, that's the MEMS, all right, so it's a sensor. Okay, so two different ways. First, we use like inherent CMOS thin film. That means CMOS, because we have an interconnect, just like a PC board, you see the PC board, all right, so advanced PC board, we have many components on there, so how to connect them, we use multiple layers of metal. Right, again, we are talking about this, how thick this is, each like a blue metal layer is about 0.5 to 1 micron All right, again, the diameter of hair is 50. Here we are talking about half to one micron. It's very thin, but we can use these metal layers and the oxide in between them. Just use this very thin structure to create devices, sensors. All right, so the method, basically, we can etch using metal as a mask to block the ions, then we can etch into the pattern and then into the silicon, and then we do end card. We control the ions to have end card to release this suspended structure. All right, this is the thin film CMOS MEMS. Actually, you can imagine, so the CMOS, the oxide, the metal, they have residual stress, we have some special mechanical parameter there. After we release, basically you can see the curing effect of the device. But it's this particular one is capacitive sensitive, extremely sensitive. Even we have this disengagement, missing engagement, still we can get a pretty high sensitivity of the device. But generally this has size limitation, can create a very large device. But even with this, we have in the industrial product, all right, MEMS IC using this thin film CMOS MEMS to create this very smart guys. Basically, they use a thermal effect to sense the motion. All right, so they create a thermal bubble here, so you will have an initial like a motion. Basically, the bubble will have an initial basically roll, for example, to this side. They have a temperature sensor there that can sense the first direction of the motion. And then, based on the differential, the temperature difference actually on this side and the downstream and the upstream, they compare, they can sense the motion. So this is the MEMS IC is one company using this thin film CMOS technology. And this Acoustica is a spin-off from Carnegie Mellon University, actually, where my PhD advisor graduated there. So they have a spin-off company right now. It's purchased by Bosch. All right, Bosch, the digital microphone. They start to deliver to our smartphones and other industrial products. Okay, so this is a thin film technology. And then if we want, just I mentioned the thin film, the mask, right, it's very small. For some devices, we do need large pore mask to increase further the sensitivity. How to increase the size or increase the thickness? So this is something I did actually done in Florida many years ago. This is the technology we call bulk CMOS MEMS to include some silicon, all right, into the thin film. And it's the thin film actually. So this is how we did. Basically, we first etch from backside to define the thickness of silicon to be included in MEMS structure. All right, then from front side, we start to process. Okay, we release this and then etch to release MEMS part. Right. This way, the MEMS part, we do have silicon included in the structure. So basically, increase the mass, sometimes increase the performance, or achieve particular function of the device. All right. This is illustrative model of the device we did. So certainly, because of a very high integration, get three axis, we can sense like any motion, all right, in any direction. So this is the mood. Before we start, we want to check, okay, how your device will move in different directions, all right? If we have for Z sensing, we can use this torsional out-of-plane sensing, and then X and Y, yeah, we can use a particular design spring, basically to sense implant, okay? certainly then the sensitivity will be determined by the thickness of your, so that's why we want to include the silicon as now electrode material. Okay, so this is the electrostatic like actuation for force feedback and capacity sensing, right? The wiring technique is pretty complex. I will skip, just give you an idea how we can, I particularly at this, give you an idea how we can sense or we can construct like a structure to achieve this displacement sensing or motion sensing. All right, so it's an accelerometer. So how accelerometer work? So it's a, we have a central, this is a central plate, right? So we need to move to right. So this gap is closed, this gap actually enlarged, all right? So we know this is the original capacitive, capacitance, and then after we linearize this effect, okay, we can have this 30C proportion to this displacement. And then how about we connect probe mass to this central electrode. Okay, we get this, then suspend this probe mass by this spring. Then when it's applied, this is subject to any motion. So we have this Newton's law, and then this acceleration will be proportional to dx. Then because the spring constant, it will be here proportion to DC. Then you help over particular wiring, and we can get this differential sensing shape, and then with the help of a circuit, we can get the signal out. All right, so the, your output voltage will be proportional to motion. So that's how actually all the in your smartphone, and the vehicle basically use this kind of device to any motion and the control. Okay, this one I'll skip, it's very complex. All right, so this Z sensing is very hard to achieve. So, for differential, so we create a method basically to not only to get this differential sensing but also cancel this like offset. This is the very particular, and then we have designed circuit certain to pick up that small dark C change. Yeah, because it's electro, it's a capacitive, we must modulate the circuit. Because you're not an electrical engineer, probably you don't know what, how this can be done. Right, then we, this is the layout, as I mentioned before, different color represents different layer or different material. When in fabrication, they do layer by layer, but this is the design. Right, after we get this, and then we process, we etch in using the method we described, described before, and create the central, this MEMS structure, and then the circuit actually is certainly, is the end is the top layer, so you cannot see that. All right, so this is the macrostructure of the sensor, the motion sensor. See the gap. All right, between this, the electrodes, the only 2.1 micron. All right, we have hundreds of these cone drives. It's extremely sensitive, but very challenging in fabrication. That's why in industry, this still using wet edge method. All right, this is the, by the way, it's dry. Dry means we use the plasma to etch. All right, so this is a different process. Okay, so then you calibrate this in static dynamic test. So this is the test detail and time domain frequency response and dynamic. Then we get all these performance parameter figured out, and then we compare with the industry. Certainly, the performance is much better. But as I mentioned, industry they take different approach because this. The yield could be very low. For them, they just want simple ways to create the structure. So that's why they totally separate the structure and electronics. Later on, they just bond them together. That's the industrial approach. Here, it's good for some probably product and some research, right, to demonstrate some ideas. Okay, and then we apply this for example, to monitor this, the small animal motions. This was done a long time ago. Okay, so then at OU, we have other, we create this simple, it's also CMOS accelerometer, CMOS motion sensor, but here we use piezo effect. We use the polysilicon and CMOS layer. So as our sensing element, they will wear them in different ways to form the wisdom bridge, and then we still can detect the differential signal, okay, in Z motion. So using differential methods, then we calibrate, we characterize it to get the, we call it low cost. It's very simple. The fabrication is very simple. So we just released and. Actually pretty sensitive. And then we also use this CMOS MEMS method, this in 2010, okay. So we use this structure to sense extremely small force. This force, same thing, force you create displacement, then you can sense this displacement, right. This is the for cell motility studies, again, it's application in biology research. And this MEOMS, MELS, all right, microelectro-optical mechanical system, all right. So this actually is a macro mirror, all right. So we get this. I mentioned before in DLP we have millions of macro mirror. Here is for large mirror. For example, this one is used in tomography. Tomography, you have two light beams, one as reference, one is basically scanning on surface of a sample. So basically we create this kind of scanning mirror and this the reference mirror. It's an electrothermal matter. You see, apply current, it can move up and down. Basically your light path will be different. Okay. These are all CMOS MEMS devices, and then this is for other group, all right? So for other, probably Europe. So they also use this CMOS MEMS to create a varactor. Varactor means variable capacitor. This is an important device for RF MEMS. Basically, you heard about the filter. Filter basically just filter out a signal with different frequency, all right? Using inductor or using capacitor. You change the capacitor, basically you change the frequency. So this varactor, variable capacitor, is for RF MEMS applications. Okay? They also use this CMOS MEMS, but it's a combined, right? They use both wet and dry edge matter to create this structure. And this most recent is the analog device start to use SOI CMOS MEMS. It's also CMOS MEMS, but now they use a different material. It's SOI is the special material. It's still silicon, but they create this silicon on top of another bulk silicon separated by one layer of insulator. So it's this way the top MEMS layer is better defined, the thickness is better defined. Alright, so the method I use, basically you etch, then you check how much is left, so you use like a timing or frequent measurement, that's probably industry is not doable. So they just create this SOI predefined thickness of that structure layer, and that's the most recent. Okay, same approach but a different material. Okay, this is my like a CMOS MEMS topic so far, and I think the timing is fine. It's basically I talk about basically the matter to integrate electronics and MEMS together. Particularly, I just focus on monolithic integration, right? So to create MEMS in silicon substrate or on surface using inherent CMOS layers, right? So that certainly different matter, different processing technologies are involved. And in terms of application, we find so many, right? So for motion sensors, even for actuators, like scanning mirrors, all can be created in this manner. Right? Then the rest basically I can quickly show for like a biomedical project I did in the past few years. So mainly, this is 2014. I took REU students to Chicago, this EMBC conference there. So we have one paper present there. This is another one, basically. It's a magnetic sensor I'm working on right now, basically try to detect magnetic field image from our body. Or anything happen, probably we'll get a different magnetic field. So this way, we call it the cardiographical. All right, so try to measure human body magnetic field using this particular device. It's a magnetostrictive and piezoelectric effect combined together physically. All right, so this is the device. We create the device using MEMS technology. It's hugely reduced. Originally, just use the raw material, and now we create a particular shape and get pretty nice sensitivity. This is the some microstructure of the chips you have seen. This is the principle, basically how we can actuate them. It's the SEM image of these devices. I will skip this videos. I show you one here for this gripper. And this one actually is for measurement of CSF. It's hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus, basically you have water in the brain, all right? So this is now how they can only be treated, all right? So no way to cure, basically. For the neurosurgeon, they want to know, okay, what's the flow rate of this CSF fluid. Actually, the principle is here, we must direct this excess CSF flow into the body. Then you absorb, and then you have this circulation. Otherwise, probably the patient will be very painful. And they want to control this flow rate, but before control, you must know is the flow faster or slow. They have like valves to control. So we help basically to measure using thermal meter, basically it's called time of flight. All right, so we have two sections of the shunt. All right, so the neurosurgeon says it's doable. You just embed the metal titanium tube. So then we use this meter. So we have a thermal excitation here. Then we have we measure this temperature response downstream, and then we by check this dirty tube, we can have we decouple this fluidic effect and the thermal effect, and we have a rough idea, okay, so how fast, how slow the CSF is inside. All right, so we get this some measurement. We haven't published this in the conference. We're working on the June paper to report detail of this, and we push this to actually is the lowest limit. All right, so normally this is from 0.03 to 0.8. All right, for different patients, different with different ages, probably is a different way. We want to use this matter, we push to the lower limit, seems it's a measurable, all right, just have a rough idea what it matches, because we have a certain pump, right, provide the standard velocity, and then we measure this the difference of the time, and it roughly match, or basically it's just verify the idea, because there's no way to have a MEMS device embedded in how you power it, right? That's the problem. This way we avoid that, like electronics and battery. Okay. The other one, this case, we call it PEMI. It's portable autonomous multi-sensory intervention device. Basically, I collaborate with the school of nursing here, so we want to monitor this senior people, especially with dementia. Basically, this is a very famous syndrome. It's called dusk syndrome. Late afternoon, these patients somehow get very excited and they do some damaging, all right, even kill themselves. So we want to detect when anxiety start to occur for particular patients. So we have this band, all right, all this awareness. We measure their heartbeat. We have measure the impedance of the skin, basically check the sweat level. And they have some symptoms, basically, we can detect, all right? So wirelessly. And the innovation here is this is the suggestion from the school of nursing, basically. They have a very good program there. This thing is very useful, all right? So before, certainly in technology, we can detect each patient, and we can alarm the nurse, all right, they will know who is anxious now. But the thing is, if the nurse is the basis, they cannot provide help. And this actually temporarily can soothe the patient. This we call the multi-sensory effect, all right. So the asthma therapy, so it diffuse some good smell, play the music they like, and also have some fancy effect. Yeah, it worked, actually. We took this, yeah, this is like a Paris started test. So this is physiology parameters. And we took this to a nursing house there. This is senior people, they grab that, they like this kind of toys. And they, yeah, that's the result of starting. Particularly senior people like this, like a ocean animal, somehow. And they just grabbed this, and we did some tests. Unfortunately, we didn't have enough subjects. So this still, we cannot publish this real results on patients. So this, for the others, we also have some other small projects. Basically, it's related to MEMS fabrication. For example, this one, we want to release MEMS in ambient. All right, we use some theory, crack development, and try to break this in ambient rather than in vacuum chamber. I mentioned for plasma etching, actually, that's the final release is in the vacuum chamber. Here, we design particular structures, then we embed the heater inside, then we try to burn the structure in it. And it seems it works. Again, I collaborate with some math professor. They are still working on the model, how to have a theory to predict how the structure. All right, so that's what I have today to introduce to you some applications of MEMS and overall MEMS technology and some of the applications. Have any questions?
Could you just explain the differences again between the wet and the dry etching?
Oh, good questions. That's the wet etching means basically we just use solution, all
right, to etch silicon, because silicon is a crystal. Single crystal, because we have different Miller indexes. That means you etch from different direction, you have different shape. So that's the first generation how you create a structure, membrane or cavity, basically. That's the, we have particular solutions with four types actually. I'll not go that detail, but that's related to your crystal structure. You must have particular like a shape. Normally it occupies pretty large size. And then dry edge is plasma. Plasma, we have an external electron field to guide the radicals directly into the trench, so we can have very straight cut. So you can imagine then you can reduce the size. And also it's probably is more environmentally friendly because everything is confined in the chamber and then you can pump out. Solution basically you etch, then you mask down somewhere. And the etching rate, the controllability different.
Maybe you can comment on which one is it a little bit easier to do MEMS first and then CMOS afterwards, or do CMOS first and then do MEMS afterwards? Which is the more traditional approach and which is the one that's...
Yeah, like a very fundamental question, a great question. Here, definitely it's based on different applications and for different community. All right, industry, that's why I mentioned the industry, they must have their dedicated facility. Very expensive, then they can create based on their particular device, they can either have pre-CMOS or intermediate CMOS. And in research communities, academia, we use more like post-CMOS, simply because we have freedom for foundry access. So we can have our design create, we just tape out, send out the layout to Moses, or Moses ask you, oh, you want the TSMC, you want HP, you want on semiconductor. So we have more choice. So, but more choice, that means basically you must, when design, you must follow their design rules, right? So we cannot have our design ask an analog device because they have an intermediate CMOS. They will not fabricate for you. So their industry company, they have their particular solution. And we in academia, so because we have open access to some foundry, that's why we choose this foundry and then we create non-structured data. So that's why most of research academia we use a post-CMOS.
I guess I should make a comment for the people who are here from bioinstrumentation is that, you know, as we talked in class that there are issues of sensing and then taking the signal to the electronics that not only introduces noise, but that makes the system larger. So the whole thing is that if you can put the electronics and the sensing unit, which is usually something mechanical, very close to each other, then you can miniaturize the whole thing so that you can really, really small. And also you can get better signal to noise ratio that way. So that before the noise can enter into the system, you can already do things like amplification, or you can, you know, filter it out and things like that.
It's a good point. I didn't mention that this is called overall. Yeah, we reduce the parasitic effect. If you have a flying wire to connect together, so this wire will create some noise. So then everything is on the same chip, or you bond them together with very small size. How small? The device that you see, the video, the tweezer we see, that's huge for MEMS. A real MEMS device is even smaller. All right, so this the metal mounts process, I just show you there, the minimum structure is 8 micron. 8 micron, the device that I show you later on, basically the gap is only 2.1. All right, so that's
what do you see? Actually, that's a huge mass. The real mass device is even smaller. That small, you can imagine, pick up the signal, it's very small. You definitely will lose it. That's why you must modulate that particular frequency and the noise just for you. You cannot let it work at low noise. Low noise, we have that famous 1 over F noise. You may or may not heard about this. It's a particular term for electronics. When you are dealing with low frequency signal, the noise is huge. So we must modulate signal to high frequency to cancel some noise. Then we demodulate. That's what I mentioned, modulation and demodulation. We have reasons to do that, all right? Method absorptor is right, basically, to deal with the signal. The instrumentation is also extremely important. But why not? Because your signal is picked up first by a sensor. Why not directly put your electrons right next to the sensor? That's the necessary for CMOS MEMS integration.
And just maybe a general question there. So you show picture of one undergraduate there. Do you normally receive undergraduates or it's mostly graduate work? Like all the things you
have this is mainly for graduate. Yeah, this is for the device, the design, fabrication, characterization, this is a graduate work.
So
they
get training at U of M and then they go down
there? Yeah. I pay a lot of money, basically, to U of M. So in these few years, probably, I paid around 60,000 just for fabrication fee. So not for tuition and stipend for student. So it's expensive. So there's this research is you're not talking about the cost. So just to demonstrate some idea. But the undergraduate is, for example, for the CSF flow rate measurement, definitely undergraduate student can do something. And for example, the RU student, within 3 weeks. Actually, I forgot to mention one from Lawrence Tech. It's a pretty good David Inward. Anybody know him?
Probably from a different
2014. Yes, it's from an electric engineer. So here, yeah, in 3 weeks, and I said the first the neurosurgeon just say, oh, just put an ice there, and ice pack there, so you can check the temperature difference. And later on, I talked with the undergraduate. We have a particular device, which is electrothermal device, actually electrocooling device. And he designed circuits to get like within 2 weeks, 3 weeks, he got that particular device. And now, we don't need ice. Ice, basically, you put there, you may mess up the temperature because of the contamination. And then this is solid state cooling. You just put there, turn on power, and it can cool down. We have a date there, like a 20 to 40 seconds. Then you can take the measurement. So undergraduates can always put value to the system.
So I think we'll stop right here and then thank our speaker one more time.
All right.